right? Was it something which you derive from your own life to say, I'm going to make a film on a teenager who's committing suicide because of depression? Was it your own analogy, or was it because you saw someone close to you? How did it start?
So the topic of mental health issues has affected my family, both my extended family as well as my nuclear family. So, I mean, not the family I grew up in, to be clear. So it's something I've always cared about. Living where I live in Silicon Valley in California, I've witnessed a lot of like the pressures that are put on young people and the kind of struggles that they face in trying to meet expectations and live up to the pressures that they're under. And so that was a big inspiration. There's a whole slew of suicides in Silicon Valley, a cluster of 14 in 1 year. And that was, you know, shocking to everybody. And right before I started writing the script, there was a girl who jumped off the overpass of one of the highways. And I knew her, actually. I mean, I didn't know her very well, but she was someone who was an acquaintance. So it was really, you know, it was really shocking for most people what happened there. And so that really, you know, inspired me to start writing the story.
Suchi, you are playing Rupa, the mother of Maya, who commits suicide because of depression. You know, you are a mother in real life. You've got a 10-year-old daughter. When you were working on a subject like this, were you picking up tits and bits from your own life and adding it to Rupa?
Well, I was just hoping that something like that would not happen in my life and in my daughter's life, frankly speaking. Yes, my daughter is 10 years old, and I do see, you know, the pressure that causes kids to go through, you know, depression or, you know, isolation, etc. I see it in our everyday life as well. I mean, she's in the fifth standard, but this need to perform, Mama, I need to get good marks. You know, I want you to be proud of me. And I said, where does all of this come from? I'm happy even if you don't get good marks, it's all right. You know, but they feel the pressure from such a young age. So when this script came up and everything, of course, it did touch a chord. I've not luckily not had depression, but my grandmother, my mother's side of the family has suffered through it, and I've seen it from a young age onwards what it does to people. So I knew about it per se, but when the film came up, I have to say, I mean, I was the only thing I was hoping and praying is that it would never happen to my daughter. So it really helped me as far as waking up and smelling the coffee and seeing, because we all are in nuclear families. I'm part of a nuclear family as well. And to know what not to do, you know, to prevent it from actually happening in my family.
Pooja, you've had quite a journey in your life. You've been vocal about every aspect of your journey as well, which I really admire. Have you ever gone through, like Suchi was just saying now about performance pressure? I have to excel in my films, I've got to excel in every department, which at one point of time made you wake up and say, I'm not happy with life because of performance pressure. Have you gone through that?
I've gone through more than performance pressure. First of all, I'm sorry I'm sounding overtly husky today, but I just am recovering from swine flu.
You're sounding more bassier than I am.
Well, maybe I am more bass than you are, darling. But anyway, that's not the point here. The thing is that I think that when I first became a director with a film called Paap, my father, I remember, wrote me a letter on the day of the release, and he said to me, he said, well, Pooja, while, you know, this day for you might be the most monumental day, you're releasing a film as a director. And for me as a father, I kind of oscillate between the dread of you failing and the hope of you succeeding. For the world, this is just another day. And there are more people out there in Bollywood who would want to see you fail then want to see you succeed. And if you're surprised by that, then which world have you been living in? This is Planet Bollywood, darling. And there is no gratitude in this business. So there's an illusion in people's heads out there that filmmaking, acting, the arts is a place which is kind of full of highs and, you know, events like this where we sit in air-conditioned rooms and we're kind of looking pretty. It's a journey that is just laced with humiliation, frustration, self-doubt. You have to constantly tell yourself that you're worthy because everybody around you is making you feel unworthy. I mean, when we were acting back in the day, when we were modeling, Suchi, me and Suchi go back a really long way, we didn't have the pressure of social media. But we still felt so pressurized by society to be the women that we were. And we were born to mothers and fathers who allowed us to be us. But not everyone has that privilege. And I'm just so glad to be here on this day, sitting with these women to kind of make a film that deals with depression, to deals with things that people don't want to talk about, is such a brave act. And I applaud you for that. Because, I mean, it takes a lot to put your money where your mouth is and your belief. And, you know, people say, but, you know, you guys don't make relevant films. I'm like, do you really want to watch our relevant films? And somehow it's left to us filmmakers and to us artists to maybe really steer the world towards, like what you said earlier, we've lost our moral compass. We don't share enough anymore. We might be having dinner in the same house on the same table, but we don't know what's passing through the other person's head. So pressure is there. Pressure is there on you from the time you're born into the world. That's if you make it into the world as a woman, either you're kind of, your life is just annihilated before you kind of even make it out, because I mean, they prefer a male heir. And then society is trying to kill your spirit. And then you enter a business where you're dissected constantly for how you sound, how you don't sound, the standards of the world. And we buy into it and we fall for it. And this obsession with showing this together face, this happy face, you know, I'm okay. I'm not okay. It's such a relief to hear people say that, I'm not okay. You know, we don't ask for help and we don't hear each other's silences enough, which is why they say to know each other intimately is to know each other's tragedy. You know, if I don't know your tragedy, I don't know you. That when I share with you what your fears are, is when I know you. And we live in a world where we're comfortable sharing bodies. You know, we're comfortable sharing drugs, but we don't share each other's fears with each other. We don't share vulnerabilities. And for us in the artistic world, it's a dichotomy, because if we lose our vulnerability and if we lose the accessibility we have to our emotions, then we stop being artists of the kind the world wants to applaud. But at the same time, you've got to go out into the world and be in control and show your together face and not be sensitive and not feel anything. So we're constantly being forced to lead this kind of schizophrenic existence. To find that balance, I think, is tough. But I think the fact that we're here and we're talking about this is the greatest kind of step forward, because you can only confront something when you can acknowledge it. I confronted that I had an alcohol problem by acknowledging I had an alcohol problem. I was deeply depressed. And I thought that the balm that I was using, that was alcohol, was actually kind of going to take that kind of pain away. It made it worse. And until that time, I could actually recognize that about me. I couldn't step away from that. So we all have our ways. Some people deal with depression with workaholic, you know, with work. And as long as you're a workaholic and you're making money for somebody, they don't care about you. But we are all addicts in a way. For some people, it's work. For some people, it's sex. For some people, it's drugs. For some people, it's money. For some people, it's power. For some people, it's fame. So we live in a high-stress world. We have tremendous pressure. We feel increasingly more and more alone. We are on Facebook with each other, Twitter with each other, liking each other's posts. Where do we reach out to each other? It's a virtual world. I mean, my friend Subhash, our old friend Subhash Keja, we used to keep telling him, yeah, you have a virtual relationship with people. You're not sitting in front of people, na? And touching and smelling them. Where are we touching and feeling each other? My father supposedly left home when I was a little girl. According to the world, I come from a broken home. But my father never left home. It was a matter of geography. So you can be in the same household with a supposed functional family, but that family can be the most dysfunctional family. And the supposed dysfunctional family can be the most functional family. It's about being there for each other, hearing each other. Jo hum chupate hai na mere dost, wo hum hote hain. We are what we hide. And how many of us are really saying what we feel? How many of us are really having a real conversation? So which is why I brought along a little letter, and if the time permits, I would like Suchi to read it. My younger sister, Shaheen, suffers from depression. She realized that when she was 13 years old. And, you know, we confuse sadness for depression, melancholy for depression. Hers is a crippling depression where wo dino ke liye matlab uth nahi sakti hai. My father put it beautifully. He said she wakes up in the desert every day. and waits for spring, you know? So when you wake up in that wasteland emotionally, and it's very easy for people to say, you know, when Jia Khan committed suicide, I remember Alia and Shaheen and my father lived right opposite them. And Alia came back, she was mortified. She said, what's going on? And we're like, you know, this young girl has killed herself. We were all very upset. We knew Jia. And me and Shaheen were talking about suicide. And she said, have you ever contemplated suicide? So I said, of course I've contemplated suicide. I think every wise or sensitive person at some point has thought that, what if I just kill myself? What if I do? And Shaheen said, yeah, even I have. Alia was mortified. Alia was like, what's going on? Both my sisters have contemplated suicide. What kind of house am I living in? You know what I mean? But the point is that if you can say these things, you generally don't go and pull the plug. It's when you can't talk. It's like, why is Alcoholics Anonymous popular? Because most people don't have anyone to talk to. So the stigma of depression, the stigma of mental health, the stigma of alcoholism has to go. I remember many years ago, there was a young man who kind of went in with a sickle or just slashed a young girl from the Northeast at Gateway of India. Ironically, it was my wedding anniversary and me and Munna were going to Sri Lanka where the foreign minister was shot. So there was curfew. So everyone's like, Sri Lanka mat jao yaar, bahut, bahut, bahut dangerous hai. I land in Sri Lanka and I hear about an incident in Gateway of India in broad daylight. Someone's gone and hacked a girl to death. Why? Because he was suffering from depression. And hum bahut aasani se ek dusre ko pagal bol dete hain. Like even when my father made a movie called Arth, there was a scene where Smita Patil's mother and a doctor approached Shavana Azmi. And there was a very senior actor, Om Shivpuri, who had come at that point. And my father said, you're supposed to say in dialogue that she's suffering from paranoia, schizophrenic paranoia. So he said, ye kya bulwa rahe hai yaar, bol do na, pagal hai. So my father said, nahi, pagal nahi. This is paranoid schizophrenia. There's a difference. So you see, we kind of tend to sweep things into one bracket, and to simplify it, and then I will not speak anymore. We just need to share more, talk more, reach out and hold each other's hand more. We live in a time where we don't have a problem. Like I say, we share bodies. We don't form connections. We're frightened of bearing our soul. You can deal with my naked body. You can't deal with my bare soul. That's the problem with the world. And I don't want part of that world. And if I'm supposed to be called mad, I would rather be mad with my truth, as Nietzsche said, than be sane with your lies. So that's where I am. But to finish off, congratulations, congratulations, congratulations. We need more work like this.
Thank you.
Suchitra, she just mentioned a letter which Shaheen had written.
Yes.
You have it with you. I'd love you to read it for us. And very thoughtful of Pooja to get it along with us. So thank you so much. I'm just